Hello visual effects people, I'm AK, talking about the upcoming FluidNinja.Live version 2, specifically about water on landscapes. I would like to summarize these features I have been working on for the last 2 months. All information available at the community Discord, recently updated, the most important information being Live 2 is coming this year, and the system is fully reworked under Niagara. And for the water on landscape features, we utilize 2 specific stages, simulation stages. One reading mesh distance fields and the other one reading landscape elevation data. And we use these stages to construct an elevation field, a height field, and a gradient, a velocity gradient from it, which defines flowing direction. We are going to talk about 6 group of features. First, elevation. The most simple case is having no landscape. The simulation is flat, and we use that as a zero ground or point of reference, adding mesh elevation on top of it so the water could flow on top of the meshes. The second most typical case is having a landscape, and so we could access landscape elevation data and in the same time use that as a zero point, as a reference point to read the mesh distance fields, and we are combining the 2 fields so the fluid is flowing over both the landscape and the meshes. And the third case is having no landscape and or scene is entirely composited of meshes. In this case, having no reference point, we need to use a top-down scene capture camera accessing the scene depth and constructing the elevation field using this one. Second, flowing direction. So we have constructed our elevation field and now we have to tell the fluid which way is down. And for this, we use the gradient of the elevation field. We already had a directional field in the fluid simulation called velocity, so we are adding landscape gradient and mesh surface gradient to the fluid simulation global velocity. And so we have this complex behavior where the fluid is turbulent and tends to flow downwards on surfaces. Problem is, surfaces are not evenly sloping downwards. What if we have a gap or a hole? And soon we figure out we need to fill these gaps on uneven surfaces to keep the global downward flowing tendency of the fluid. So we have arrived to point 3, which is filling gaps. And to do this, we have to accumulate the fluid. And for this, I had to introduce a new simulation buffer called mass, which is the height of the fluid column. And not only accumulating the fluid, but also where it goes, we have to average out, we have to blur the landscape elevation below the fluid. Please have a look on the left thumbnail. You can see the landscape elevation is getting blurred, averaged out, so the fluid surface remains smooth despite flowing over uneven, noisy surfaces. 4. Extending the simulation area. The problem is, or simulation is finite, and sometimes we need large water surfaces. So one method to overcome this problem is to lock the simulation area to a given location and then use non-interactive patterns to populate the area outside of the simulation. And so if we keep the player inside the interactive area, he won't even notice. And the second method is, we could attach the simulation to the player. Please have a look at the yellow bounding box, a 50 by 50 meters fluid simulation attached to the player, so it is always surrounding the player. Obviously, the disadvantage is, if we have a complex arrangement of fluids and the player is advancing fast, we cannot build up the desired configuration. Point 5. So we have our simulation correctly placed in the world and we would like to influence objects around the simulation, and we could do that by using a modified density buffer called wetness or wetmap, calling this buffer in the material of the surrounding objects and channeling it into roughness. We also would like to project caustics on the objects around the fluids, and we have to break it down into 3 types. The first is utilizing a single layer water shader technique called depth behind surface. The second one is using the previously mentioned wet map to figure out which rocks are arching over the fluid simulation, and we are projecting the caustic pattern on the rock surface in a top-down manner, filtering on rock surfaces with downward-looking normals. Notice how the caustic pattern is advected by fluid simulation velocity. And the third type, very roughly, as a post-process technique, is underwater caustics, and the camera is also under the water. Point 6, caching. We have been talking about this under point 4. It takes a while until the fluid builds up a complex configuration. Let's say we don't have a flat land, but a tricky creek bed with branches, and it takes a minute until the fluid is reaching the desired configuration. So the method is to run the simulation and wait until the desired configuration is building up, and once we have this and it looks nice, then we can save all the simulation buffers, capturing a single frame of data of density, elevation, velocity, and all these needed data sources. And we are going to use these data sources to define the initial state at next simulation start. So that is how we kick off a cached simulation. Finally, about future plans, it would be so nice to have a bunch of GPU particles driven by simulation velocity for white water and splashes, and I also would like to advect objects with simulation velocity. Thanks for your attention. That was a first quick glimpse into FluidNinja Live version 2, and see you later.